Good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome you all to our service today for the second Sunday in the Easter season. Back in history, this Sunday had a strange name, perhaps, because it came out of the Latin. It still stands today. If you've looked at your bulletin, perhaps you saw it at the top of the first page, called Quasimodo Geneti Sunday. Sounds like something that came out of the Cathedral of New Ulm in Paris, I guess it was that. Yeah. It's really a Latin term that comes out of the Psalm for today. The Psalmist actually went to the book of 1 Peter instead of the Psalms besides that. And it begins by saying, and I have it listed there, like newborn infants, or as newborn babies crave milk. So the encouragement to God's people are to crave this pure spiritual milk of his word, especially now following the resurrection, that we would grow up in our faith. You know, a child can't grow unless it has its milk, and we can't grow unless we listen to the words and promises of God. And especially following Easter, that was a very important message because many, many years ago, even so in many of your congregations where you grew up, you know, Palm Sunday, it was a time of confirmation, perhaps in many of your congregations. Yes? No? Yes? In many places it was. Easter was a time of baptism, and long time ago, this was Confirmation Day, this first Sunday after Easter, long time ago, before any of us were around. So the encouragement then was, in your risen Savior, young people and adults, many adults, keep growing and keep desiring that pure spiritual milk of his word. So that's the idea behind the name for this Sunday. Traditionally, the reading for today, the gospel, is always the story of Thomas. Doubts and belief. That will be part of our service this morning. Today we follow the order of morning praise on page 45. And as we begin, Emily, are you the only one here today? Come up for a children's devotion. How are you today? Ooh, you were up here all alone for once. We could have Wade come and sit with you too, maybe. No? Let me look over the crowd here a second. No, I don't need a volunteer from you. You won't work, actually. He will work. And he will work, yes. Question for you. If I, or this man here, offered to sell you shampoo that guaranteed hair growth, who would you buy from? Did you hear that or not?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you said Scott?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
If I, or this man here, sold you vitamins that guaranteed you would never ever have to wear glasses again, who would you buy from?
Chris.
Oh, they don't want to buy from you at all. Okay. If Chris or Scott or I offered, we have to include one more. For this man would tell you never to be afraid again of death, who would you believe? Yeah. And that's really the point of this all. Man can't do a lot of things. He can do some things, he can't do a lot of things, but he can't take away the fear of death. And that's what Easter is all about. And the reason he can calm our fears is because he went through this for us, right? He rose again on Easter. He went the way of the cross to prove our sins and died, but rose again on Easter. And by that he shows he has that power over death. And because of that, you know his word is a guarantee that everything he says is true. So when he tells you not to be afraid, whatever that might be, But especially at Easter time, we think of sin, death, and the devil. And he says, don't be afraid because I have overcome them. You can trust him because he does what he says. And he says and can do everything. So think of that today, okay? We'll bow our heads in prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, there is no reason to ever doubt any of the words that you or your Son give to us, because you have proven through your power, through your authority, and to the fact that you are God and our Savior, that you have done all things necessary for our good now and in eternity. So may we never, like Thomas, doubt these things, but always give us that type of Easter faith that trusts you in everything in life, knowing that you can do all and you will do all for the good of your people. Give us that faithful trust in you now as we hear your word and grow in our faith today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up. We'll see you next time. Again, we follow the order of morning praise, the matin service on page 45, and that service begins with the singing of our opening hymn, 148.
Let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful
psalm for the day. That is Psalm 16. You'll find that on page 68 in the front of the hymnal. Psalm 16 on page 68. Psalm 16 is what we refer to as a messianic psalm, in which a prophecy regarding Christ is definitely portrayed here. David speaks of his own life to a certain extent, especially in the beginning portion of this, but this is more about Christ, and it is recorded as such in the New Testament times, and especially as you get to the end, you will recognize the resurrection that is there, and Jesus' dependence upon his heavenly Father. We sing responsively the psalm. I will sing the first half of the verse, and the congregation will respond with each of the second half of each verse. We also ask you to sing the refrain portions. There are three of them. And then finally, the glory be to the Father towards the end. So our first reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 18, beginning at verse 1. Paul is in the city of Corinth. He is on his second missionary journey, and we hear of how things went for him there. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth, and he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to leave Rome. And he went to see them, and because he was of the same trade, he stayed with them and worked, for they were tent makers by trade. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and tried to persuade Jews and Greeks. When Silas and Timothy arrived from Macedonia, Paul was occupied with the word, testifying to the Jews that the Christ was Jesus. And when they opposed and reviled him, he shook out his garments and said to them, "Your blood be on your own heads. I am innocent. From now on I will go to the Gentiles." And he left there and went to the house of a man named Titius Justus, a worshiper of God. His house was next door to the synagogue. Crispus, the ruler of the synagogue, believed in the Lord, together with his entire household. And many of the Corinthians, hearing Paul, believed and were baptized. And the Lord said to Paul one night in a vision, "Do not be afraid, but go on speaking, and do not be silent. For I am with you, and no one will attack you to harm you. For I have many in this city who are my people." And he stayed a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. Here ends the word of our Lord from the first lesson. Our epistle lesson is recorded in the first letter of John, chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. Whereas the first lesson we read was about those who had rejected the news of a risen Savior, John writes about himself and the rest of the apostles who received the word of the risen Savior and then believed. As the Lord came and showed them the authority that he had as the Savior, the risen Savior and Lord. John talks here about some of the things that convinced them regarding Christ and him as the Savior. We read in 1 John 1. "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life, the life was made manifested, and we have seen it, and testified to it, and proclaimed to you the eternal life which was with the Father, and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things, so that our joy may be complete." Here ends the reading of the epistle. And we now ask the congregation to rise for the reading of our gospel lesson. Today, the gospel lesson is recorded in the book of John, the 20th chapter, beginning at verse 19. This takes place at the first half of this lesson on Easter evening, that first Easter evening, and then a week later. And two thoughts that were also reflected in the other lessons for today. One is that some people reject that news of a risen Savior, but that Savior also has the authority and the compassion to come to those people again and again, like with Thomas, and give them that confidence in him. Then he sends them out, and that is the other idea that is here, being sent out to proclaim the gospel. We read in John 20. "On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors were being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, 'Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you.' And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld.' Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe.' 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here, and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe.' Thomas answered him, 'My Lord and my God.' Jesus said to him, 'Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed.' Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Here ends the reading of the Gospel. The Lord is risen, he is risen indeed, and death has been swallowed up into victory. Alleluia. Congregation may be seated as we continue with the singing of hymn number 156. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." In Christ Jesus, their fellow redeemed in our Lord. Have you ever noticed that whenever a person blesses or curses someone, that in the end, nothing ever really happens? For example, how many sleepless people haven't angrily yelled at their neighbor's dog at midnight and nothing happened? Or how many amateur carpenters haven't howled in pain with a runaway hammer that struck their thumb and nothing ever happened? Nothing ever really happens in many ways when a man curses, or for all that matter, when he blesses too. But thinking of cursing, there's no flashing lightning that comes down from heaven to destroy the hammer or the dog. That really goes to show that many things that man gives are just empty wishes, because he really has no power to complete what he says. Men can huff and puff on their own, but in the end, they can't always accomplish things. Now, the same is true when man blesses under his own authority. He may wish and hope, but he really has no ability to make that blessing happen. How many blessings have been spoken in our world without anything ever really taking place? But when God blesses, or when God curses, things happen. Think of the Old Testament. God utters a curse upon rebellious sinners, his children of Israel, when they continued to rebel against him and Moses. And for some, he opened up the ground and it swallowed them. Fire and brimstone fell from heaven upon those who refused to give him glory and destroyed cities. Armies were wiped out, or they lost their will to fight because God had spoken against them. And a similar thing happens when God blesses. A wandering Abraham, who had really had no home other than a tent, is given a great name, he's given many descendants, he's given the promise of a Savior that actually did come, and to his people a land that was flowing with milk and honey. A poor widow's jug of oil and jar of flour never ran dry during a famine that lasted 3.5 years when the prophet stayed with her. A paralytic not only had his sins removed, but he rose, took up his mat, and he walked home for the first time in his life. All takes place when God speaks. So unlike man's word, God's word is a word of power. When he speaks, it happens. So it is that when Jesus stood before his disciples and he said, "Peace be with you," it happened. That was more than Jesus just wishing that his friends would have a nice day. His blessing removed the fears that they had, like that, immediately. Likewise, when he says, "If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven," it happens. These were words of blessings that were backed by power that he could grant whatever he said. Now look at the setting here. This is evening of that first Easter day. Jesus' disciples are full of fears at this point, not having seen him. The master had been arrested, he'd been put to death just 3 days before this. His enemies had screamed out for him to be crucified at that time, and I think the disciples were afraid now they were going to be coming after them. Would they have to undergo the persecution that Jesus suffered? Would they have to undergo death like he did? Fear so overwhelmed them that they barred themselves in their houses behind locked doors. Everything that had mattered to them before this had been taken away from their point of view when Jesus had died. And then suddenly, right in the midst of them, and in the midst of their fears, the Lord Jesus stood. Peace be with you. Wow. That must have been quite an effect that his word of power had upon those disciples and their hearts. There he stood, not just wishing them peace, but actually imparting his peace into their trembling lives. It was as if their trembling hearts had been changed in a second, and their hearts were now at rest. Jesus shows them the nails in his hand, nail prints in his hands and his feet, and they realize, finally, that he was exactly who he had always claimed he was. And they knew that he had done exactly what he had always said he would be doing. You see, his words were true because they are words of power and blessing that come from God. And when he speaks, it happens. I don't know that we could ever really understand the indescribable calm and rest which Jesus' living presence must have given those disciples, those scared disciples that night. All of them felt it, except for one who wasn't there, Thomas. He missed it that night. But when he was there with them a week later, and Jesus came again and did the same thing, appearing with his power and his blessing, that blessing came over Thomas as well. It drove out all of their fears, fears of their enemies, fears of their guilt for sin, fears of death that they might have. All of that was gone immediately. Now that's what happens when God speaks a word of power and blessing. It drives out fears. Because that is the purpose of the gospel. It is the power of God unto salvation to all who would believe that. A similar thing happened at the very beginning of the New Testament, if you really think about it, as what happened here. In fact, it's almost the same thing to a certain extent. God sent the angel Gabriel to Mary. Then he sent the angels to the shepherds around Bethlehem. And what did they say? Stop being afraid. And what happened? Their fears were immediately gone, and they rejoiced and went to see the Lord Jesus who had just been born. Because that Prince of Peace had the power and the blessing that he could impart to people. Jesus was going to correct all the consequences of sin eventually, and that fear would then be taken away. He writes it at the cross, and then he really completes it at the empty tomb. And here in person, the Lord Jesus proclaimed to these men. No angel was sent in this case. The Savior himself, who is the instrument through which that peace comes, pronounced it and simply says, peace to you. How special that was. God and sinners reconciled by what had taken place during those 3 days. And that's no different for us. God's word of blessing and power still comes to us in Christ. He may not stand in our midst, but his word and his promises are always there. Believe it and you have it, just like the disciples did. Because it's done. Sins are forgiven. Hope is alive. And heaven is opened. God promised that when he said that Jesus would be given over to death for our sins, but that he would be raised again to life for our justification. God promised it, and he did it. You could say that he cursed sin and death at that time, and he blessed us with life. Man huffs and puffs and can't accomplish things like that, but when God speaks, it happens. And to every sin-laden heart, he says, peace be with you. It's a word of blessing and a word of power that drives away our fear. And because it does that, Jesus now sends us out with that same message to proclaim. That's not what we are to be doing. We're to be proclaiming the word of peace to all. No angel is going to do that. And the Lord Jesus himself is not coming back to do that because he has returned to his heaven to come back only one time at the end. But we are now the instruments through which God works to bring this word of power and blessing to others. That's why Jesus continued in our text. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. You see, dear friends, Jesus never intended his disciples, nor did he intend us either, to keep this word in blessing and power to ourselves. Instead, he was sending them out with that word to proclaim it. And because they did, we have it too. Likewise, a whole church is sent out to proclaim this because it's God's will to be done. And what are we to proclaim? Jesus gives two specific messages here. To the stubborn heart that doesn't repent of sin, acknowledging a desperate need of the Savior, the church is to proclaim your sins are not forgiven or they're held against you. But to the repentant heart that flees to the Savior for help, the church is to proclaim your sins are forgiven. And those sins, along with the fears, are sent away because God's word of blessing is a word of power that not only declares it, but actually does it. Now, we call this twofold message, if you can go back maybe to some of your confirmation days, the ministry of the keys. It's that special power and right which God has given to his church here on earth to forgive the sins of the penitent sinners, but to refuse forgiveness to the impenitent as long as they do not repent. And as a member of Christ's church, you are called to proclaim the same message and to send it away, send the sin away. You are to use these keys. They either open the door of heaven to those who are repentant and believing, or they close the door of heaven to those who refuse to repent and believe until they do repent and believe. You are to use them with friends, you are to use them with families, you are to use them with co-workers. All are to hear this word of God's power and blessing. And to those who are not repentant and refuse to believe this, God's word is clear. Your sins are still against you. No peace. But to those who are repentant, God gives a very different message. Your sins, no matter what they have been, are forgiven. Peace with God is yours. You know, sometimes our Lutheran churches are actually attacked because we teach this. And we say that the pastor, yes, the whole church, has a right to send away sin this way and to tell everyone that their sins are forgiven. And usually those who oppose this kind of a teaching say something like, only God can forgive sins, and therefore no man has the right to forgive sins of another man. And that's true in part. Only God can really forgive sins and pay the price that's necessary for sins. But it doesn't follow that no one has the right to tell others that their sins are forgiven for God's sake, because God may certainly use people as his instruments through which he gives his forgiveness to this world. And here Jesus tells us to do exactly that. He commands his church to send sin away in Christ's name. So what does that mean? Okay? When you tell anyone that his sins are forgiven, then you are just doing what God told you to do. And God himself, who has been the one to forgive those sins in Christ, and the sins of the whole world that he does forgive in his heart, he doesn't come to men to speak that word. He told his church on earth, he told his Christians on earth to go out and now do this for him. And when they speak his word, it is a word of power and blessing that does send away sin and give peace to the heart. So it is that when you tell someone that he is a sinner and that he deserves to go to hell for his sins, you are telling him the truth, for this is what God tells us about all men in his word. And when you tell people this, they ought to believe it. If they don't believe it, they are actually calling God a liar. On the other hand, when people have learned that they are sinners who need that Savior, and that that Savior has come, and we tell them that sins have been sent away for Christ's sake, then they ought to believe that too. Because Christ himself said, if you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. And when a pastor stands before you on Communion Sunday or any other Sunday, in the Lord's name, called by the congregation to do that, and he tells you, I forgive you all your sins, then just remember that the Lord Jesus himself, who died to pay for the sins, told us to do that, and sends us out to do that, and that he stands behind that statement. You can be sure that your sins really are forgiven, because God does not lie. He does what he says, and he says what he does. And the best part of all of that is that we, like these disciples, know what that peace feels like within our hearts. We have it because it is God's own word of blessing. It is a word of power in which he does what he says and he says what he does. And God grant us always the faith that believes, accepts, and does this for his name's sake. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please remain standing. And a little bit different than the morning praise service for today. In your bulletin, you have an insert that's known as the Ministry of the Keys, which is what was just spoken about in our text. We'll use this as our confession of faith and remind us of these different parts of what Jesus was speaking in our text for today. Please note the parts that will speak this responsively. First of all, the keys. What is the use of the keys? The use of the keys is that special power and right which Christ gave to his church on earth to forgive the sins of penitent sinners, but refuse forgiveness to the impenitent as long as they do not repent. Where is this written?
The holy evangelist John writes in chapter 20, Jesus breathed on his disciples and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone of his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven.
And now, how are these keys used in a public setting? How does a congregation use the keys? A Christian congregation with its called servant of Christ uses the keys in accordance with Christ's command by forgiving those who repent of their sin and are willing to amend, and by excluding from the congregation those who are plainly impenitent that they may repent. I believe that when this is done, it is as valid and certain in heaven also as if Christ, our dear Lord, dealt with us himself.
Where is this written? Jesus says in Matthew chapter 18, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven.
Now the congregation may be seated as we continue with the singing of hymn 277 in place of the Te Deum Laudamus that's normally sung in this morning praise service. Hymn 277.
God, we praise you. God, we bless you. God,
rise. As we continue in the prayer and blessing portion of morning praise service, we begin on page 50 with the singing of the Kyrie.
In the morning, O Lord, I call to you. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O risen Lord, you came to your disciples and took away their fears with your word of peace. Come to us also by word and sacrament, and banish our fears with the comforting assurance of your abiding presence. Bring to us that word of power and the word of blessing, as you have brought to your disciples at the time that you rose from the grave, putting all of our fears at rest. And we ask that you would be with those who are sick and struggling with difficulties in this life, that you would give them that rest, knowing that you will abide with them always. Be especially with Lois as she is in the hospital at this time, and grant her release from any pain that she might have and quick healing over the days that lie ahead. We also pray that you would bless the offerings that we bring to your altar today. Use them to your glory, and so that the gospel, this power of a risen Savior, and the blessing that he brings may go out into the world. And, O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power, and grant that this day we neither fall into sin nor run into any kind of danger. And in all that we do, direct us to what is right in your sight, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Let us praise the Lord.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you both. Amen.
You may be seated for a singing of our closing hymn. Please note the stanzas we sing, 5 through 9. 5 through 9.